In every aspect of human society, there are examples of things we simply accept as the truth. But if we give it a little bit of thought, we find we've got to call these things into question. Don't swim immediately after eating. You have to eat the crust. That's where all the vitamins are. Aside from the song, there is zero archaeological or historical evidence that a disco inferno ever took place. In the machining world, probably the best example of this is that you must thread with the compound. Does it work? Sure. Is it the only way to do it? Absolutely not. In this video, I'm going to cut two identical threads, one using the compound and the other using the crossfeed. I'll discuss the pros and cons of each technique and where you might want to use one over the other. Most importantly, I'm going to compare the two at the end and see if there's any noticeable difference. So grab your threading tools, engage the half nuts on that subscribe button, and let's get started. To keep everything as close as possible between the samples, I'll be using the same material, the same thread, and the same tool. The material is alloy 360 brass, which is the standard for machinability that all other metals are compared against. I'm using this instead of something harder because I want to eliminate as many possibilities for chatter as I can. Since it's so free machining, I also know it isn't going to eat my high-speed steel cutting tool, so I shouldn't have to resharpen it between samples. I'll be cutting my samples on either end of the same piece. To keep track of which side is which, I'll mark the compound side with a C and the crossfeed side with a The F stands for feed, in case you're wondering. The thread will be 1 inch 8. I'm using that because it's big and coarse, and you're much more likely to have chatter issues on large threads because of the larger tool contact. Plus, the thread and any issues that occur with it will hopefully be big enough to capture on camera. In metric terms, this thread would be 25 millimeters in diameter with a 3 millimeter pitch. As I'm cutting each thread, I'll talk about the technique that I'm using. Threading with the compound requires the compound to be angled to just less than half the angle of the thread, so most of the cutting is done on the left-hand side of the tool, although a small amount is still removed by the right side, just enough to ensure a good surface finish. That angle will be either 29.5 degrees or 60.5 degrees, depending on where the 0 degree mark is on your compound scale. Some lathes have the 0 degree mark over here, so the compound would be perpendicular to the spindle axis. In this case, the angle would be 29.5 degrees on the scale. Other lathes have the compound parallel to the spindle axis when it's at 0 degrees, which would require an angle of 60.5 on the scale. Either way, the angle compared to the part is the same. The tool is originally touched off and the crossfeed dial is zeroed. I also zero my DRO as well to make sure that I'm not off by a turn on my dial. On each pass, the crossfeed is brought into zero and the tool is advanced by the compound. At the beginning of the thread, you can take a heavier cut, but each successive cut should be a little shallower since you're taking off more and more material with each pass. This is true for both compound and crossfeed threading. Threading with the compound means there's less contact between the tool and the part, and therefore less chance for chatter, especially on harder to machine materials. It should also mean less wear on the tool, which is definitely a concern in tougher materials. Theoretically, it should be easier to get a good surface finish, although in practice, this is arguable. There are a lot of things a machinist can and should be doing to ensure a good finish. In both methods, it's good practice to take a spring pass at the end, where you just return the tool to where the last cut happened and run it again with no adjustments. This tends to scrape off just a little bit of material and remove any chatter marks that are there. I do this before every measurement to make sure I know exactly how the tool is behaving. Here's the thread as cut with the compound, and it's actually a big surprise to me. There's a lot of chatter on both flanks of the thread. Normally, brass is incredibly forgiving with its surface finish, so this really took me off guard, but it's raised an excellent follow-up question that I'm going to go ahead and do. First of all, I'm going to cut the other end of this piece exactly as I said I would using the crossfeed, and I'll see if we get similar results. Then I'm going to do a second piece, again with the compound and the crossfeed, but this time I'm going to use cutting oil. Normally, cutting oil is not really necessary on brass since it's so free machining, but I'll see if it makes any difference at all to the surface finish of these threads. I'd like to take a quick moment to say hello to my latest patron over on Patreon, Eric Brummer. If you'd like to help support the channel just like Eric and get access to some decently funny gag reels, check out the link down in the description. I'll also give you a shout out in a video just like this one, and I'll splash your name up in the end credits as well so you too can have a well-deserved sense of superiority over a bunch of strangers on the internet. By comparison, threading using the crossfeed is a little bit simpler since you're just feeding straight into the part. There's not a lot of setup involved in cutting threads this way. This makes it really good for cutting multiple identical parts because you simply feed into the same depth on each one. You do, of course, still want to measure when you're doing this since your tool will wear over time. This is also often used when cutting multiple stark threads. The crossfeed is used to cut the thread to depth, and the compound is set parallel to the lathe axis and is used to advance the tool by the thread pitch to cut the other starts. I put out a video not too long ago where I cut a double start stub acme thread with this exact method. If you haven't seen that, I'll put a link to it down in the description as well as in a card at the end of the video. I'm also planning a video where I demonstrate different methods of cutting multi-start threads, so stay tuned for that one. Cutting threads this way means each side of the tool is cutting equally, which means a lot more of the tool is contacting the work during the cut. That tends to lead to more chatter, but again, in practice, this can be mitigated by adjusting your technique during the last few passes. I find I get the best results by taking extra spring passes before measurements and on the final cut. That tends to scrape off any offending chatter marks that might have formed. Here's the results of cutting the thread with the crossfeed totally dry, and the results are very similar to the compound dry. We've got plenty of chatter marks on both flanks of the thread. Let me go ahead and put in another piece, and we'll do compound and crossfeed with cutting oil this time and see if it makes any difference. I've cut my other two samples with oil, and even with lubrication, there's still quite a lot of chatter. There are a few possibilities that come to mind as to why. First of all, there's just a lot of contact between the tool and the part, although I would still expect there to be more chatter on the crossfeed samples, and I really don't see a difference between them at all. I guess that answers my original question. Flex in the part or the tool is probably negligible. Neither was sticking out terribly far. The center height of the tool could have an impact, especially in a grabby material like brass. I was very careful when centering the tool though, so I think it's the least likely option. The most likely is that brass is a material that machines best at high speeds, and since the thread was so coarse, I was running my lathe at its slowest RPM. A good indicator of this are the thread reliefs on the two samples, which were all cut using the threading tool. I cut this one first and cut the thread relief at high speed before putting my lathe in back gear for threading, and it's quite nice looking. However, when I flipped the piece around to cut using the crossfeed, I didn't bother changing speeds. I just plunged in and moved over at 50 RPM. The surface of that one is torn and chattery, and the same can be said for the thread relief on the crossfeed side of the oil sample, which I did the same way. With that in mind, I made sure to go back to high speed to cut the last relief, and it looks great as well. Perhaps my choice of material was actually misguided. This brings up an excellent follow-up idea though, where I'll test the same thread at various RPMs to see if that makes a difference. I'll have to change my setup a bit to make sure I am far away from the chuck, because 8 TPI at higher RPMs is going to have a very high pucker factor. Stay tuned. The question you're all probably thinking is, which one of these do I use, compound or crossfeed? Well, both, and most of the time my decision is based on speed. At home, I generally just leave my compound angled for threading unless I need to cut a taper of some kind. That way, I'm ready for threading whenever the need arises. At work, though, There are several other people using the machines, and the compound is usually set at any angle other than the one for cutting threads. Since I'm usually trying to crank out a part quickly, I'll just use the crossfeed rather than change the setup. In other words, I'm far too lazy to look for the right wrench. Let me know which technique you prefer to do down in the comments. Don't forget to hit like and subscribe while you're down there, and check out my Patreon page if you'd like to help support the channel like these wonderful people right here. If you want to see more of my, quite frankly, amazing content, check out my most recent video over here on the right, and over on the left I have a playlist of all of my machining test videos. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.